The November 9th, 2015 meeting of the City of Danville Planning Commission is now called to order. We welcome everyone here to the meeting today. The Planning Commission is an advisory board to the Danville City Council and is comprised of members who serve on a voluntary basis. Today we have five items to consider for which there will be a public hearing. One item is not for public hearing. Anyone wishing to speak for or against the case may do so at the time. After the public hearing, commissioner members may have questions for staff and for those who have spoken for or against the requested change. Planning Commission will review the case relative to the city code and make a recommendation to forward on to City Council. Council will consider these items at their December 7th meeting. I believe, is that right? December 7th? It's not, what is it?
21st.
That's what I had on my sheet. I know that sometimes it always gets off.
December 15th meeting
then.
Yes,
15th. Okay. All righty. And if we have the roll call, this time.
Mr. Scares?
Here.
Mr. Dotson?
Present.
Mr. Garrison?
Here.
Mr. Jones?
Here.
Mr. Wilson?
Here.
Ms. Evans?
Here.
Mr. Bolton?
Here.
Okay. First item, we're going to take on the agenda item number three first. So this will be the special use permit application, PLSUP 2015-0000290, filed by Julie Brown, requesting a special use permit for indoor commercial recreation in accordance with Article 3M, Section C, Item 4 of the Code of the City of Danville, as amended and located 209 Trade Street. The applicant is proposed to provide a space for event rentals. We could have a staff report, please.
The subject property, 209 Trade Street, has been operating as a microbrewery and microwinery since it was issued a special use permit in 2012. As a secondary use of the structure, the applicant, Julie Brown, would like to occasionally rent out part of or the entire facility to individuals or groups for their use. Within the zoning classification of HRC Highway Retail Commercial, indoor commercial recreation facilities are allowed by special use permit in accordance with Article 3M, Section C, Item 4 of the Code of the City of Danville, Virginia, 1986. Seven notices were sent to surrounding property owners within 300 feet of the subject property, and a full report is in front of you. Staff recommends approval of special use permit application PLSUP 2015-0000290 to allow indoor commercial recreation in accordance with Article 3M, Section C, Item 4 of the Code of the City of Danville, Virginia, 1986, as amended at 209 Trade Street. Staff recommends approval with the condition that hours of operation remain limited to a maximum of 6 o'clock a.m. to 2 o'clock a.m. Monday through Saturday, and 6 o'clock a.m. to 12 o'clock a.m. on Sunday.
Okay, we'll open the public hearing at this time. If there's someone wish to come and speak on this item, you can do so at that time. Anyone wishing to speak? Okay, I'll close the public hearing.
They are here. I just wanted you to know that. Okay.
Okay. And I look to commissioners for any comments, questions, a motion.
I have a question.
Okay.
Indoor recreation. Why is this coming before us now? Because there has been indoor recreation in the past at this facility, correct?
Not at staff.
Where they've charged to lease the facility out.
Oh, okay.
It's when you charge the event, similar to what they've done on some other places. We just had one up on North Main not too long ago. To have and operate it as their own business, they don't need to. It's when they charge and lease it out to other people that it changes that over and needs that special use permit.
Okay. On top of their special use permit?
On top of the one that they already have, yes.
Okay.
Any other questions?
I'll make a motion.
Okay.
I move recommend approval of special use permit application PLSUP 2015-0000290 with conditions per staff.
Okay, you have a second?
Second.
Second by Mr. Garrison. Look at the top of the roll, please.
Ms. Evans?
Yes.
Mr. Dotson?
Yes.
Mr. Bolton?
Yes.
Mr. Jones?
Yes.
Mr. Garrison?
Yes.
Mr. Wilson?
Yes.
Mr. Scares?
Yes. Okay. All right, the next item is rezoning application PLRZ 2015-0000292, filed by Mr. Malik and Mr. Riaz, requesting to rezone from TOC, Transitional Office Commercial, to Conditional NC Neighborhood Commercial at 1009 Main Street. The applicant is proposing to rezone to allow to open for operation for a convenience store. And in conjunction with that, there's also a special use permit application, PLSUP 2015-0000293, filed by Mr. Malik and Mr. Riaz, requesting a special use permit for the operation of a convenience store with gasoline sales in accordance with Article 3J, Section C, Item 3 of the Code of the City of Danville as amended at 1009 Main Street. The applicant is proposing the operation of a convenience store with gasoline sales at this location. If we could have a staff report, please.
The subject property, 1009 Main Street, is zoned TOC, Transitional Office Commercial, and is located with the Old West End Historic District at the southeast corner of Main Street and Holbrook Avenue. The subject property has operated as an automobile repair facility with gasoline sales for approximately 87 years. The applicants, Fiaz Malik and Muhammad Riaz, are requesting to rezone the property to conditional NC neighborhood commercial to obtain a special use permit so that they may continue the gasoline sales and replace the automobile repair operation with sale of convenience goods. According to our records, the present structure was built as a service station in 1969, replacing the existing service station that was built in 1927. Since at least 1987, the operation has been legal non-conforming. Approving the above rezoning and special use permit request will allow the expansion of use to a convenience store with gasoline sales and remove the non-conforming status. 1009 Main Street is located within the Old West End Historic District. Any changes proposed to the exterior of the structure or parking area that is visible from the public way will need to be reviewed by the Commission of Architectural Review. The applicant has voluntarily proffered to remove a number of uses from the NC Neighborhood Commercial designation, see Exhibit A. The added condition that the only alcohol will be sold is wine by the bottle. A request similar to today's application was heard and denied by the Planning Commission on November 10, 2010. The applicant withdrew the request prior to the corresponding City Council meeting. 22 notices were sent to surrounding property owners within 300 feet of the subject property, and a full report is in front of you. The request to rezone this property from transitional office commercial to conditional neighborhood commercial creates a situation known as spot zoning. This is where one property owner is afforded special consideration that is not afforded to other property owners within an area. Illegal spot zoning may occur when this rezoning is not consistent with the land use plan for the area and solely benefits one property owner, not the general public. Spot zoning may be acceptable if it serves the general public purpose and is consistent with the land use plan. 1009 Main Street has operated as an automobile service station since at least 1927, and while this operation is legal non-conforming, the operation has only been closed for a couple of months. Therefore, it could continue its operation as an automobile repair establishment with gasoline sales or any other use allowed in the transitional office commercial without any actions from this commission. The applicant, however, wants to alter the operation to include a convenience store and remove the repair component. Staff does not believe that this rezoning request is illegal spot zoning. However, staff does not believe that rezoning 1009 Main Street is necessary. The property has been a viable commercial establishment for gasoline sales and automobile repair for more than 80 years. The property has not has not remained vacant for any extended period of time during those years. Therefore, staff is not convinced that the transitional office commercial zoning is inappropriate and that a neighborhood commercial designation is necessary. If it is the desire of the Planning Commission to approve the rezoning and special use permit requests of the applicant, staff recommends that it be done so with the conditions voluntarily proffered by the applicant and conditions determined by the condition in regards to hours of operation.
Okay, thank you. I will open the public hearing now. For those who wish to like to come and speak on this item, may do so.
Mr. Chairman, members of the commission, and members of the city administration, my name is James Daniel. I'm an attorney here in Danville, and I am here today representing the applicants and who are here on the front row, and as well the owner of the building, Abercrombie Oil, representative there, Mr. Vic Phillips. We are here requesting this rezoning and the special use permit. The city staff has told you what this building has been, and since all of you have been in Danville as long as I have, or many of you longer, you're familiar with the fact that there has been a service station there for years. It is my understanding there's actually been a service station in that area since 1916. The building that presently stands there was built in 1969, as was pointed out. I believe actually the building has been vacant for a little bit longer than a couple of months. What has happened in the gas sales business and car repair business is that a store or a shop like the one there at the Exxon on Main Street is no longer economically feasible. Cars, as I'm sure you know, have gotten far more complex. Computers are needed to service cars to do any heavy mechanical work, and the money that is realized off the sale of gas, the profit is in the larger stores such as the Sheetz. The gas profit is down considerably. It's simply no longer economically feasible to have a service station and a mechanic there at that location. The real question today I submit to you is, what is the best use or the repurpose of an existing but vacant building? I respectfully submit that to give this rezoning and special use would not be illegal spot zoning in the sense of attempting to drastically change the use of real estate. We're not attempting to go from pure residential or a light use to an intensive use. As has been pointed out, there has been a service station, it is my information, for 99 years. Cars parked waiting for new tires for mechanical work. Cars in and out for gas on a constant basis. Noise, an air compressor. Used to go there to put air in the tire of a leaking tire that would leak in my car. There was an air compressor right there at the front corner. It created noise. There was lighting used for the gas station. We are not suggesting a more intensive use, really, than what has been there. What should be the approach? Do we let property sit vacant or provide a benefit to those who travel in this area while working, people who live in that area, and do we try to minimize the impact of the use of such a building? Last Thursday night, my clients and I met in a home on Main Street with concerned citizens who live in the surrounding area. I will not tell you that we changed any or many minds, but we did make every effort to answer questions and provide information about what the use would be by these businessmen. These folks are successful. They have a store in Lynchburg. The store is clean, well-maintained. It has a delicatessen. They cook chicken and fish. They serve a variety of foods. They have donuts. They have four or five booths for indoor seating. This would be a store that would not have beer. We don't want people walking on Main or Holbrook with that brown bag drinking that can of beer. That's not what this store is about. We believe that such a store would actually be a complement to the area. There's already Midtown Market. It would be a complement to Midtown. They don't intend to cook Christmas turkeys or Thanksgiving hams, but they would have wine by the bottle, and I don't mean the cheap variety of wines, and they would have some prepared foods. Mr. Phillips contacted numerous people in the area. and the some are actually excited to see this type of business locate there. I have numerous surveys that Mr. Phillips collected from folks, people who work and some who live in that area of Main Street, and I'll be glad to show those to you if I might.
Sure.
Also, we have some pictures I believe were submitted with the application, but we have other pictures of the store in Lynchburg, which we believe will give you the proper idea of what these gentlemen intend to do. Now, approach. This could be a great place for people to pick up a sandwich for lunch, to get some chicken on their way home. It could be part of a neighborhood, part of rebuilding Danville. As I said earlier, we submit that this is not really illegal spot zoning. There has been an intensive, what I would call a heavy use, mechanical work, gas sales. These folks are not looking for a fight. They do not want to be poor neighbors in the neighborhood. They want to be good neighbors. What will this do for this area and for Danville? It will, as I say, repurpose currently dormant property that the city has been realizing reduced or diminished tax revenue for the past many months because there are no sales taking place. Does that building deteriorate with time? I submit to you that it will without use. Repurposing it, putting it to use as a convenience store, will bring somewhere around 8 to 10 new jobs. Mohammed here will move to Danville to operate the store. It will be a new business in the neighborhood, convenient for people who live there, people who work in the doctor's building, who work in the dentist office along Main Street. This is an area, as you know, below that called Millionaire's Row, an area that we're all so proud of. If I were coming before you today saying, let us tear down one of those buildings and put in a convenience store, I know what the answer would be, and I would not be here asking for that. But this is an existing business. This is a building that can be used. The only change, and I realize they would have to get approval from the CAR, but the only change they would make would be take out the 3 bay windows to close that up to have a building that there would be, the doors would be removed, same brick would be used to make it into an only interior store. We believe that would enhance the neighborhood, that would improve the area, and we ask that these applications be approved or that you recommend their approval. And the applicants are here if you have questions that you would like to ask them. Thank you.
Thank you. Any questions for them right at this moment? If not, we can wait.
Yeah, can we come back?
Okay. Anyone else wishing to speak on this item?
Okay, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Fran Boffman. I'm not an attorney, and I'm sure my presentation won't be quite as eloquent as Mr. Daniel's presentation will, but I'm willing to give it a go. I live in the historic West End neighborhood. I'm one of the people who live within 300 feet of the property in question and did receive the letter in the mail. And I am speaking today on behalf of myself, but also the West End neighborhood. People who I'm speaking for would like to stand. We also have put together a petition. And I know the attorney for the buyers have presented a good case for the people who work in the area and how this might benefit the people who work in the area. But that benefit to the people who work in the area would come at a cost to the people who live in the area. I have a petition here that was signed by 223 people. Who live in the area. The majority of them, the overwhelming majority, live in the West End area. A few are coming from Beverstone, a few from Forest Hills, but the overwhelming majority are the people who are the homeowners in the West End Historical District. Did you want a copy?
Yeah, you can just pass it around. Can you pass me up when you get through?
Okay. The people who signed this petition are the people who would be directly impacted by having a convenience store with gas station, with gas sales in the neighborhood, as well as the people who live nearby would also be impacted by this change. We respectfully ask that you look out for the citizens of Danville today and deny the zoning change and special use permit for the property located at 1009 Main Street in Danville. The property owners in this area and the city of Danville have worked hard to revitalize this area, including the River District and the Old West End Corridor from downtown to Avery University. The area has come a long way from where it was 20 years ago or even 10 years ago. The area is doing well. We've had several ribbon-cutting ceremonies in the past few months. In addition, over the past several years, crime in the area has decreased significantly thanks to the efforts of the citizens of the area, the help of the Danville Police Department, City Council, and Mayor Saunders, all of whom have worked closely with the neighborhood, with the community on events like the recent Neighborhood Night Out. Downtown Danville and the Main Street Corridor has changed from being the place to avoid in Danville to being the place to be in Danville. The challenges we now face are twofold. The first being the sustainability of the progress made to the area to date, and the second is to sustain the momentum that we as a group have achieved to continue the development in the area. The decision that you all make today will be a milestone decision that will determine not only the future of the Main Street area, but the future of Danville. One has to ask several questions regarding the issue of the convenience store with gas sales. Does this convenience store benefit the residents of the area? Does this align with the City Council's 2030 vision of where we would like Danville to be in 5, 10, or 15 years? How will this impact people's perception of the area, and what will be the impact on the quality of life, health, and safety in the area? The answer to number one is that there is no direct benefit to the residents of the community. Convenience stores tend to be higher priced than other outlets for the same goods. The choice of food items is limited to non-perishables, so it is not likely that local residents could purchase fresh fruits, produce, or other healthy items. Studies have shown that children who live in close proximity to convenience stores have a higher rate of obesity than those who don't. The profit made by these stores is driven by junk food, tobacco, and alcohol, as well as lottery tickets. They profit from those who can least afford the higher prices and prey on vulnerable citizens by enabling smoking, gambling, and alcoholism. From a health and wellness perspective, the noise, light and air pollution, and littering would adversely impact the area. Although this location has been a gas station for a long time, it was opened well before the impact of having a gas station in a residential area was fully understood. Recent studies have shown that air contaminants can extend up to 300 feet beyond the gas station, and prolonged exposure can result in many health issues, including brain damage, heart damage, fetal development issues, and many other health problems. So today, if we were proposing to put a gas station in this location, it would likely be declined, but this particular station is grandfathered because it's been there for a long time. It has been suggested that this particular store will be different. To me, that just sounds a little bit like putting a lipstick on a pig. This answer to number two is that this does not align with the City Council's 2030 plan and independent studies that recommend that this area be developed to encourage heritage tourism and bring visitors to the area. People's perception will be altered, given that neighborhood stores like this tend to create the impression that the area is potentially unsafe, especially when the stores are open late and people are loitering about. This property is in the heart of the historical area. The design guidelines for the historical district, according to the state of Virginia, empowers you with the ability to preserve designated landmarks and develop in their surrounding areas from destruction, damage, defacement, and obviously incongruent development, and ensure that uses are compatible with historic landmarks. Many of the homes in this area are on the National Register of Historic Places and are subject to protection. Based on the belief that the area is protected and the city has a development plan in place, the homeowners in this area have spent tens of thousands of dollars, and in some cases, hundreds of thousands of dollars, on renovation and repairs to maintain their properties. The answer to number three is that the quality of life will be significantly impacted by this change. Currently, if one were to observe the area on a daily basis, he would see that the area is family-oriented residential. In the morning, he might see students from Avery running down or walking downtown from the college, parents with small children in strollers taking walks, pet owners walking their dogs, retirees taking their daily stroll. In the evening, people might be sitting on their porches greeting passersby. In addition, tourists often take the walking tour of the homes on Main Street, and the Historical Society hosts the annual Holiday Homes Tour. This could all change if a convenience store with gas sales were to open in the area, because this would fundamentally change the character and perception of the area. If the area is not an area that people can walk in and feel safe due to the increased traffic, potential crime, and loitering that comes with convenience stores, it would be a real detriment to the city. Although the applicants indicated that they would accept input from the neighbors, the fact is their acceptance of our requests on limitation on hours and sales of goods was met with resistance. The proposed hours of operation, approximately 6 a.m. to 10 p.m., especially the closing time, are not in keeping with the residential nature of the neighborhood, nor are they consistent with other area businesses that typically close at 5:30 or 6 p.m. In addition, the potential owners plan to leave the lights on 24 hours a day, a necessity in a business that has a high crime risk potential, but a detriment to the homeowners adjacent to the property. When asked if the buyers would enter into a binding agreement with the neighborhood or the city to limit hours of operation and alcohol sales if the zoning change were to be approved, they were noncommittal. This is an area of concern because without a binding agreement, these buyers or subsequent buyers could potentially change to a 24/7 operation with full-blown beer sales and wine sales, and no input or approval would be required. Another area of concern is the potential for increased crime in the area. National police studies have shown that 6% of all robberies occur at convenience stores. Although this number may seem small, the percentage remains unchanged. Over the last 30 years, the percentage has remained at 6%, with many stores being victims of repeated robberies. Convenience stores are often perceived as being easy targets due to location, low number of employees, and the ease of escape into the surrounding neighborhoods. It is well known that the area several blocks to the east and west of Main Street are higher crime areas as reported on the Danville crime map. And Mr. Corp here has a copy of the two-year Danville crime map.
David Corp, Holbrook Avenue, visual aids.
This is the 2013 crime map. We put this little jewel here to indicate the proposed convenience store. Basically, the darker the color, the higher the crime rate, measured in number of crimes per square mile. So the darker, the more violent the crime, or the more numerous the crime, excuse me, the more numerous the crimes. This is 2013. 2014, as Fran mentioned, were vastly improved thanks to the police department, the city, and the neighbors. The proposed convenience store would be centered at the confluence of the most crime-ridden areas. As you can see by the arrows that run from these higher crime areas, they all converge at the proposed site for the convenience store.
So the positive news here, and I've circulated a copy of the same map that you all, so you all would have a copy. The good news here is that between 2012 to 2014, the crime rate in these areas has decreased. But as with the other neighborhood initiatives, the challenge here is to sustain that positive trend. A year ago, almost to the day, November 10, 2014, we were in these same chambers discussing the same issue. At that time, you all had the wisdom to see that this zoning change would not benefit Danville. I hope that same wisdom prevails today and that you again deny the request for the zoning change and special use permit. If you do, I think that we would all prefer not to be back here in 2016 discussing the same issue for a third time. It seems obvious to us that the seller has not investigated other business models that might better meet the needs of the area residents. We would like to have the opportunity to work with the seller to develop a win-win scenario where he could sell the property and someone could open a business that would better align with the city's 2030 development plan and better meet the needs of the residents without changing the character of the neighborhood. We have several area churches, civic organizations, and area residents who are interested in working with the seller to identify alternate uses for the property that would not involve a zoning change. On behalf of the residents of West Main Street and myself, I thank you for your time and thoughtful consideration of the issue at hand and encourage you to vote no on the zoning change and special use permit. Thank you. Yes.
If you had your choice, what are some choices that property could be used for?
That's a great question, and we've debated that in the neighborhood ourselves. What we would like to see is the gas tanks removed and the gas pump removed. Some potential uses might be a Starbucks-type coffee shop where the neighborhood could gather, maybe an information center so that people who are going on the walking tours could have a place to congregate, and maybe the Historical Society could use that for meetings as well. And there have been other possible, like, neighborhood meeting places, smaller restaurants, deli-type sandwich shops, donut shops, bakeries, something like that.
Okay.
Did you have a question?
It was just Danville.
Same thing? Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you very much.
All right. Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Susan Stillwell. I've been here before. I don't live in the old West End Historic District, but I lived there for 20 years. I've been in the real estate business for 37 years, and 30 of those years were in Danville. And my focus was to restore the old West End Historic District. In 1986, I sold 5 houses on Jefferson Avenue. From there, I went on Chestnut Street, Green Street, Holbrook Avenue, Chestnut Place, Main Street. I've enticed a lot of these people to bring their money to Danville and invest, and they have spent many, many thousands, some of them several hundred thousands of dollars on their home. I'm sure you take care of your home, but you're not threatened with a convenience store in your neighborhood. I served on the Planning Commission for 10 years. And I think some people at the city wished either I would expire or they waited for my terms to expire. But I'm not afraid to come back in here and talk with you. I also serve on the Commission for Architectural Review. And I've worked with historic properties in Colorado, New Mexico, and Virginia. This is not going to be good for that neighborhood. It's still fragile. We've gotten rid of slumlords, we've downzoned properties, we've brought in new owners, now they're children playing in the neighborhoods. That was not here 30 years ago. There were slumlords there. People were afraid to go outside at night. And we don't need that to happen again. I reviewed this morning some of the details of a special use permit, and right there, the top four was to be harmonious, in harmony with the comprehensive plan, to be in harmony with the adjacent property owners. I doubt you would have any sense of harmony if this was going in your neighborhood. Convenience stores attract a lot of people from lots of different walks of life. They're the kind of place when you need money, you take your gun in there and get it. There'll be a lot of litter. There'll be loitering. None of us need that. We don't need to put up with that. The Midtown Market is there, open from 9 to 6, 6 days a week. They've been there since 1921. Anything you need to buy in that neighborhood can be bought. I see the employees of the doctor's office, the dentist's office, the residents. In fact, it's a social gathering to go to Midtown Market. Please, I beg of you, do not vote to support the rezoning, and do not vote in favor of the special use permit. Thank you.
Thank you. Any questions, Ms. Stillwell? Anyone else wish to speak?
Mr. Chairman, Commission, hi, I'm Rick Barker. I live at 135 Holbrook Avenue, which is within 300 feet of the proposed zoning change. Living on Holbrook in the historic district for over 25 years now informs my opinion on this proposed zoning change. One thing I like about Danville in comparing to other cities I travel and touring other historic districts is the fact that we have in a straight line from the 800 block of Main Street all the way to Blue Park, essentially an architectural 101 display of amazing architecture. So if we start in the 800 block, you can see pre-Civil War housing. Moving on up the block or up the street, you can see great examples of high-style Victorian houses, then early 20th century Edwardian houses, all the way up past Averett University, where you can see 1940s and 50s bungalows. And this great residential architectural inventory is only interrupted by the mistakes of the past. The mistakes, I define mistakes as those changes made on that street prior to 1972 when the local ordinance now protects that neighborhood and those properties. And if you look at some of those examples, such as the former YMCA building, mansions were sacrificed to create what seemed at the time to be a good idea, a non-conforming building there, which a generation later is now obsolete. And it's just been recently leased as a church. When we go up the street a little further, most of us can remember when the doctor's building was a populous doctor building, and it was full and there was a lot of activity. But again, a generation later, today, that building is not fully occupied and it's not a well-known destination. And so that property will be in question later. And I just use those as examples of anything that is non-residential in a neighborhood over time becomes problematic. And so from the doctor's building, if I move over to the site in question at the gas station, many of us made decisions to acquire properties in this neighborhood knowing that that gas station was there. So even though we may not like a gas station, we'd have to accept that because we knew that coming in. But changing that would be a different story. So if I can agree with Mr. Daniels that no one would advocate the destruction of antique inventory to allow the creation of a gas station today. And if that's logical, then I struggle to find the logic in suggesting that because it exists today, that expanding that commercial use would be reasonable. It seems not. If we wouldn't allow the construction of a gas station today to allow the expansion of that use, seems counterintuitive to all that we're trying to accomplish in the historic district. So I would ask that you uphold staff's recommendation and deny the change or the variance in the zoning. Thank you.
Thank you. Any questions for him specifically? Okay.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Beverly Richardson, and I live at 731 Grove Street. And if you all have been up Grove Street, you've seen the change that has happened from the 700 block up to the 900 block. I recently have gotten involved with the Westmoreland Neighborhood Organization, which at its peak had 79 members. And I also get involved, I live in the Old West End. I want to speak on the impact of convenience stores on minorities in particular. And I know that this is a touchy subject for most people, but I think it is fair and just to explain to you why convenience stores are not a good fit for historic districts, poor economically disadvantaged minorities, which happen to be in Paxton area, Green Street area, Calhoun, Dane, areas where the city has worked so hard to clean up and to make Danville a more livable place for all its citizens. On Ross, on Harbrook Avenue, on Gay, all over in the Westmoreland District, the city has revitalized and rehabbed the houses. Community Development has done an excellent job revitalizing the area, especially around Harbrook and Ross, and it's just remarkable to see the quiet and the solitude that has returned to the neighborhood. And I'm setting the scene because I was over there last night talking with a few neighbors and getting petitions from the older ladies who live by themselves. They do not need a convenience store there. There is no benefit to a senior citizen to have a convenience store there. People who are at retirement age who would like to live in quiet, peaceful neighborhoods. Now, to me, it's not an issue of rich or poor. It's an issue of quality of life, public safety, good community neighbors, people looking out for one another. I think that's what Danville needs to be about. Now, you have those flags down in the River District that says Reimagine Danville. Reimagine the old West End, extended all the way up to the hospital, all the way up to Blue Park, all the way to Schoolfield. Danville can be a bright light in this country for the size of city that it is. I'm saying this because the city is going in the right direction, but the vision has to be to keep old West End as a historic neighborhood without the inconvenience of a convenience store. Now, this situation with the convenience stores do not do anything but take advantage of the disadvantaged. Alcohol, drugs, tobacco, and lottery tickets. People who are mostly affected in the first place who do not need any more Achilles heels to overcome. And I really am disappointed that someone would have the audacity to come into a neighborhood such as the Old West End with the crossroads of Westmoreland neighborhood and want to put a convenience store there and sell alcohol, tobacco, and firearms when we know across this country the blight and the crime and all the mess that comes in poor and disadvantaged neighborhoods. And I'm asking you all to be honest, look inside yourselves and say, would you want it in your neighborhood? And if the answer is no, tell them that you don't want this convenience store and you're not going to vote for it. I thank you so much for your time.
Thank you. Anyone else wish to speak? Okay, come on up if you would, please.
Good afternoon. My name is Paul Lapey, and I live on former Millionaires Row. I say former Millionaires Row because anybody who had $1 million when they came spent it on their house. My wife and I, since we arrived 12 years ago, have frequently opened our house to visitors here in Danville. We've been on a holiday tour. We've been part of the Virginia Garden Week. We routinely invite people who are taking the Historic Society walking tour into our home. In fact, we have now, in 12 years, had almost 1,500 people come through our home. I've answered hundreds and hundreds of questions about Danville, and I have to tell you, I have never once been asked, where is the closest convenience store? Thank you very much.
Yes, sir.
I might just reply for just a moment on a couple of points. Again, my name is James Daniel. First of all, we, as we volunteered last Thursday night, we are more than happy to negotiate both with the city as to proffers and to these people who live in this area. We would love their business plan. We would love to know a better use for this property. It has been for sale for ages, and no one has come forward with a viable business plan to present to us. Lights, we have never intended, to my knowledge, to leave the lights on 24 hours a day. I've never heard that before. Loitering. These folks don't want people loitering at their parking lot and beside their store or in front of their store. People like that scare business away. You don't want that. That's not going to be a problem. They will see to that. Robberies. Yes, robberies occur. I know that personally from my own personal life from 44 years ago. But not having a business there, having a vacant building, doesn't chase crime away, doesn't reduce crime in Danville. Crime is a problem that all of us have to work on, and I think the city is doing an excellent job on that point. Since the Green Street Station opened and the community policing unit, I think you've seen a drop in crime in that entire area, and I submit that that will continue. Gas spreading. We don't want a gas station there because gas spreads. There is a gas station there. There are tanks there.
denying this zoning, rezoning application is not going to pull the tanks out of the ground. Sounds, in all due respect, that some folks don't want outsiders coming down Main Street. I respectfully submit to you that everybody should be welcome. Think how great it would be if people take a walking tour and they can go to a delicatessen, sit down, get a sandwich and a glass and a bottle of water. People visit the museum, walk over and get some chicken to take home at the end of the day. Mr. Barker raised an excellent point, and that is the beauty of Main Street going all the way up West Main to the Ballou Park area. But stop and think what is there. Stop and think. He mentioned the Y. You have a couple of lots that are asphalt that churches use for parking. You have the urologic clinic. You have the doctor's building. You have the Wednesday Club. You have 1045 Main Street, which is also doctors. Next to that was a doctor's office. You have Town's Funeral Home. You have the hospital. This is not a pristine, perfect residential area. It has been changed over the years. The dentist's office there on Main Street as it becomes West Main Street. We are not asking for a drastic change. We are not asking to be permitted to tear down a building to put some terrible use there. We are asking to be permitted to use a building that has been there. The building's not going to go away. It is there. We can't replace the mansions that once stood there. We are asking for the right to use that building for a use meeting as many of the demands of the people in that area as we possibly can, to provide 8 to 10 new jobs, additional tax revenue, and to take a vacant building, one that has not been used for several years, and make it an attractive, appropriate place for people not only in the neighborhood, but people who come and go and visit places like the museum, who take the walking tour to see what Danville once was. Thank you.
Thank you.
Let me ask some questions.
Yes. Okay, go ahead.
Jim, can you answer a question for me, please?
Yes, sir.
As you know, we make recommendations to City Council. They
right.
make the final decision.
Right.
Why did the applicant withdraw their request last year after we made our recommendation, and then they could have gone to City Council to get the final decision?
That was not these gentlemen. That was another applicant.
Different applicant. Same property, different applicant.
Same okay. property, but not
But
the
you
same
don't know
token.
Why they
No,
they
sir,
withdrew.
I do not. I was not involved in that and do not okay. know who even who it was who made the application.
Thank you.
And the prospective owners are here if you do have questions. Yes, sir.
A picture in our packet. Can't totally read all the writing at the top. Rendering prototype suggestion for Main and Holbrook, and it's got Dr. Eric's total vision care, and this is the picture. I'm curious about how this strip center thing has to do with this particular project.
I apologize. I do not have any idea. I do not know what that is, and I'm sorry.
We'll get a chance to ask him
sure.
that.
Sure.
If that
in a moment.
If we and submitted that.
So let me ask another
yes,
question.
Sir.
Did how is this I think for me a little bit, I'm trying to find how this is a significantly different application than the one that we dealt with about a year ago.
I apologize, Reverend Wilson. I do not know. I wasn't involved in that.
Okay.
Don't know anything about it. Certainly I know I assume that one difference is we have made the proffer that we will not sell beer, and it's not going to be cheap. There's not going to be I don't know if there is still a Ripple wine, and I would doubt that you would know either, but it's not going to be the cheap Manischewitz or whatever it is.
Okay. We will, I'll have some questions for staff when we get to some of that.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Anyone else in the audience wish to speak? Yes, sir. Please come up.
Excuse me, I have handouts for the commission.
just hand them to him, and he'll pass them down.
Two items of a map, and then there's a document.
Okay.
And a couple extra for the staff.
Renate asked to put in the file. So I'm sorry I was delayed getting here, and so I missed the pitch that obviously Mr. Daniels had given earlier about the convenience store. So, but the first point I can comment on.
Can you state your name for the record?
Oh, this is, my name is Steve Wilson. I'm a resident of Danville, live at 918 Main Street.
Okay, thank you.
So, first of all, what I'd like to, touch on these two handouts in a bit, but what I wanted to talk to you about is the last year and this year both, the staff recommended against spot zoning, and as you know, spot zoning in the state of Virginia is illegal, and it's been deemed so also by the Supreme Court of Virginia. But in fact, the article, in fact, the point is that it may not be illegal if it fits in with an overall city plan. And what I'd like to touch on, I think, is a different view of this whole exercise. Based on the city plan for revitalization of Danville. And so, as you may know, 4 or 5 years ago, the city commissioned a study from Allison Platt and Associates called the River District Study. And this has resulted in creating the River District downtown. And it began with rehabbing apartments there and et cetera. And now, then there's been significant vitalization of the downtown area, and there have been actually at least 4 reports, one by the River District, another for the downtown, the Old West End, Allison Platt and Associates, Hill Studios, as well as most recently, City Council has accepted the report we call the Buki Report, from CZB Associates. It's a housing analysis of Danville and incorporating housing and other contributing quality of life issues to the city for development. So that's his background to the map that I pointed out. I mean, I handed out. So did you guys get it on this side? Or you? Oh, that's staff. So it's you all, and in fact, you can have this map is actually on the city website. It's adapted from the Buki Housing Report, and this is their focus area for the next 5 years for revitalization of Danville. And as you'll see, color-coded, there's the River District, the downtown, then a swath going down Main Street all the way to Averitt and West Main. And this area along here is actually key to revitalization of the whole city. This is actually part of the city plan. Now, coincidentally, this article, just a month or so ago, Hampton Roads, Norfolk City Council was asked to insert a convenience store in the middle of a multi-million dollar revitalization project in Hampton Roads. You can actually read about this at your leisure later, but in fact, it has some parallels to this specific instance right here, and particularly as I point out on this map, here's a picture of the convenience store currently owned by the person who is asking for permission to build a convenience store. It's at the epicenter of the entire Danville redevelopment, and so I wanted to read you just a sentence. this is an email that I sent around to some individuals. This issue resonates with hundreds of residents and organizations, which I could tell you about later, along the Main Street corridor from the River District to Averitt. And in fact, the point is that the residents and the city, and developers have invested millions of dollars so far in developing this corridor. And having as they learned in Hampton Roads, having a convenience store at the gateway to the River District is a bad idea, and in fact, it's a terrible return on investment. And so, at least this was my idea a few days ago, so I contacted individuals. In fact, we've contacted a number of people outside Danville to get advice. And so I'd just like to read you comments back from Allison Platt, who actually wrote the River District plan, and in fact, two other plans for the city. And she said to show up at this meeting, and that being, let's see, logic and being right is not always enough to win the day. That's from Allison Platt. And so, but the most recently, the city plan, which is actually is a much more detailed vision for revitalization of Danville, was written by Charles Buki, who has a company in DC, about Danville and the treasure of the center of town up to Averett, the core of old Danville. And he writes, and I sent him the same map and a couple of describing this situation and the address of that Exxon station. And his answer was, that site should be a sacred protect all, at all costs site and redeveloped appropriately, which is the exact opposite from what is proposed. And so besides that feedback, I've also talked to the chair and vice chair of Danville United, the ministers of the principal churches up and down Main Street. They're all astonished that such an idea would be afoot. And so I'm hoping that a number of residents also have contributed their input. So thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else? Yeah.
Hi, my name's Dave Fieldman, and I live at 137 Holbrook, also within about 300 feet of the proposed convenience store. And I've been there since 2004, and I would not have bought that house if I'd known there was ever going to be a convenience store there, primarily because I've been through this before. I lived in a place called the Roosevelt Historic District in Phoenix, Arizona for 14 years and restored a house there. And basically the same thing happened. A convenience store opened up about the same distance away from my house there as what would happen here. And the neighborhood that I lived in had gone from, when I moved in there, a bad neighborhood to where people fixed up the houses and it became a, you know, very nice area. And I was able to see very distinct backward changes once that convenience store was there, primarily with people, you know, from outside the neighborhood wandering through the neighborhood to get there and stopping sometimes to bum change off people. There were more break-ins of cars parked on the streets and stuff like that, more trash on the sidewalks and people's yards, and more of a feeling that it wasn't safe to be out at night anymore because some of the people walking through the street, because the convenience store was open until about 10 or 11 or something like that. And it took us about 3 years to get that convenience store closed, and when it was, within a month or two, it cleaned up almost immediately back to where it had been. So I've actually, you know, with my own eyes, seen what happens when a convenience store opens up in a historic district, and I'd really hate to see that happen here, too.
Okay. Thanks. Thank you, sir. I believe there was one more in the back. Sir, did you wish to speak? Please come forward.
I do not have any paper to present, but I just want to voice my opinion.
Give us your name, sir.
I'm Dr. Alabanza. Okay. I am part owner of the doctor's building just across the street from the involved area.
Okay. Thank you.
I feel like a wolf here among the sheep. But this is the question. What is a main street without a convenience store? It is just like asking, what is Danville, the last capital of the Confederacy, if it doesn't have a Confederate flag? But that's another matter. It's just a comparison. You know, we pride ourselves with a nice downtown that's being rejuvenated. We have the Millionaire's Row that we want people to come and see. But if you get tired and you get thirsty moving and walking around or going up and down Main Street, where would you get something to drink? Or if you want to relax, maybe you have gone to the Danville Museum and you want to read a paper, where can you get it? Would you go across the river or look for another place? If you are a visitor and you go to, or you go down Main Street, that would probably be the only street you would see. And if you don't see a convenience store, where will you go? Get out as far as you can. You know, it is very important that we have something around the area. Neighborhoods or neighbors, they don't know when they will have surprise visitors. And they would need some drinks or maybe some cups. Where do they go? If you have a convenience store, you just go across the street. Now, they say that convenience stores are an attraction to those who have bad intentions. But if that area there is a convenience store, it'll be better lighted, and people walking by would feel safer. And there will be people around too, not just you walking. Unlike now, where it's very dark, you'd be afraid to walk across over there. You have people working in the stores. That's the presence of people. And you would probably feel safer that way. Again, if you feel that these convenience stores are attractions, what are all the other convenience stores doing around the town or in the county? Are they also there to attract? No, they are for the people that need them immediately. I feel that this convenience store here will do good for people visiting, for people around the corner who need things right away. This is what we should think about. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Anyone else wish to speak? Yes, ma'am.
Hi, everyone. My name is Connie Ekman, and I'm very terrible speaking in front of people, so I apologize if my voice gets a little shaky. But I don't know where this gentleman goes to see Main Street, but I don't see Main Streets with convenience stores. We have a bed and breakfast on 124 Broad Street that Paul said he's had 1,500 people through his house. We've had probably double that. We've been a very successful B&B for 8 years. We actually have someone staying at our house here that grew up in Danville, left when she was 18 years old. She has a 90-year-old mother that she comes to visit. She was a little hesitant to stay on Broad Street because she knew what the connotation on Broad Street was. She's very surprised. She brought her family over to see our house. She went downtown to the coffee shop. She didn't ask where to go for something to drink. She wanted to know where you could go have lunch, dinner, downtown. She said it was great. So I just want to tell you that I come from an area that has many historic towns. One of the ones we were just at home is Borntown, New Jersey, where Napoleon's brother came, moved, and stayed. There's not one convenience store in that downtown area. I know this isn't quite the downtown area that we're talking about, but there's not a convenience store that sells cigarettes, lottery tickets, and where high-end wine comes with cigarette and lottery tickets is beyond me, but anyhow, when you have a passion for the architect that we have come to fix up these houses, we love them. We did the restaurant, Jake's on Main. We fixed that up. There's a passion in there that when something comes in that's not cohesive with the area, it gets us, the historic lovers, up in arms because we've worked so hard, our blood and soul is in this, and where the notion comes that we don't want someone coming into this area and walk on Main Street is ludicrous. That's why we have had our house open for the historic tours, the Christmas tours, the garden tours. If Joyce Wilburn ever does the walking tours and we're there, yes, come on in. Look at the house that we have. We are so lucky to have it. I'm sorry. Thank you. I hope that you say no to this because it's not a good thing if you're trying to rebuild an area like this. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, anyone else? Okay, yes, ma'am. I want to give everybody an opportunity, but we want to cut it short now. So.
My name is Susan Wilson, 918 Main Street. I'd like to respond very briefly to what I did hear, a couple of points. One is starting the most recently, also from the part owner of the doctor's building. He was actually speaking on our behalf as neighbors, and I'd like to refute some of what he said. I do walk in the neighborhood. I live on Main Street. I have good friends on Holbrook. I pass that corner regularly. I do not feel in the least bit unsafe having it as a vacant building right now. I would feel quite differently if it were a convenience store. When it was a gas station, we did use it. We did occasionally fill our car there. We did occasionally get a tire fixed or whatever. And I was never being in, not as close as Ms. Bachman is, but still very close, a few doors down. I was never disturbed by noise from that location. I would prefer that it's something other than a gas station, but to say that it is currently a gas station, therefore should be expanded, I think is really counterintuitive and counterproductive for the needs of the city and the needs of the residents. And going back yet again to the part owner of the building, there are numerous places where someone can get a cup of coffee or a drink of some soda, whatever. There is Modern Pharmacy, which has long hours and actually has a very good pharmacy in there. It also has it has snacks and whatever. There are also places to eat in the hospital. As I understand it, there is a Starbucks in the hospital, which would possibly be having this as competition. There's, as we also heard about the Two Georges Inn, people can find many places downtown to eat now, and there's the Coffee Emporium, which I'm sure everyone here has found plenty of good things. The thing that we really want to avoid finding nearby, or in fact would prefer finding no place for anyone, for everyone's sake, is lottery tickets, cigarettes sold by the individual cigarette, and beer sold by the individual bottle. Those are things that are still being sold, as I understand, on Five Forks. That is a really bad crime area, and those of us in the neighborhood who've been here for a number of years have been working really hard with each other and with the police to clean up this neighborhood. There is nothing in what could be added in the way of a convenience store that would be, as a whole, helpful to all of us. There is no way that it would make any of us feel safer, but in fact, quite the opposite. But I did want to say something that I don't believe has been really touched upon quite enough about others in the neighborhood who do not want to see a convenience store there. And one of the reasons all of these people are not here is because the way it works, getting the announcement of who needs to sign off on a variance, affected neighbors, is really a rather small area when you have large properties. So one of the groups that was contacted in that way was the Wednesday Club, and because it's not there all the time, it's directly across the street. This Exxon, former Exxon station, is directly across the street from the Wednesday Club. It is not anything that any of the members, I am a member of the Wednesday Club, not any of the members would want to have that there, nor would the president, who apologized that she was not able to come here today to speak. My husband did speak to many of the churches in the area, including the First Baptist, which is very close, First Presbyterian, which is still closer, spoke to the ministers of both, and we did not have time to speak too much to congregants of both of those churches. Also, the New Union Church minister is very much against it, as well as the Holbrook Street pastor. So we're, as a whole, neighbors as well as neighboring entities. There's also Modern Pharmacy, which could be, in fact, impacted some on having business, which I would like to see. It's a small, family-owned, long-time-old establishment. I would want, if somebody wants to get a candy bar, a soda pop, whatever, I'd prefer that they go there where there's not all the other stuff that I'd rather them not have. You can get the bad cigarettes and whatever else is unhealthy, but at least it's not as bad as convenience store, and it would be preserving this long time entity and has been a good family establishment and has been helpful to the people who frequent the hospital as well as those in the neighborhood. And I would like to respond to just one thing that Mr. Daniel said, and that was on Thursday night, he also asked us as a group, as neighbors, what would we suggest, and we all in unison said, we have suggestions. We would like to work with him, we'd like to work with the city. We certainly would like to see that area well developed. We have nothing against selling the property. We just would like to have something positive going in there versus something negative. And so we're all for it. I know that we would have all come together more quickly to come up with suggestions had we been sought out. There is the Historic Society, which has not been asked for assistance in this. The first we knew was when these letters came out about zoning. The Historic Society was not approached. The museum was not approached. The neighbors beyond that, which was official that they needed to be approached, we were not approached. We are more than happy, and now that we've had two requests for a convenience store, we realize that we do have an obligation to come up with some ideas and to offer our help in coming up with something that would be satisfactory. We do not want anyone to lose money because they have a property they can't sell. We don't want that at all. But I do want to leave you with one thought, and that is that there is an overwhelming majority of people who have put in literally hundreds of thousands of dollars each, and some many hundreds of thousand dollars into their homes, very much a part of our entire assets. And to have something so that one individual can sell a commercial lot to make a couple hundred thousand possibly, when he's already possibly made money over a number of years, and to have so many of us lose so much of that on each of our homes. It's to benefit one seller and one owner at the detriment of so many of us in the Historic District, as well as all of Danville, for what would happen with this a very important corridor from the River District to Averett and the hospital just does not make sense. Thank you very much.
Thank you, ma'am. Anyone else? Yes, ma'am.
Hi, Kara Burton. I actually wear two hats. I live on Sutherland Avenue, close to the convenience store, but I'm also executive director of the Danville Museum of Fine Arts and History. What I have today is a request that the Planning Commission work with the Old West End and the staff of the city to develop a plan for this area. What I'm observing as a new resident to the area is that decisions are being made piecemeal. As you know, as planners, that's not the best way to make decisions. Last month, the Community Development Office came to the Danville Museum and invited the area residents, and we were presented with an update on the area by five departments: Parks and Recreation, Community Development, Economic Development, the Police Department, and Utilities. So there was over 40 people that attended that. We also have to keep in mind the interests of the hospital. I'm sure that they would like to have some input in what goes into the area, as well as Averett and the downtown area. All of these should be working together, and as I say, I request that a planning meeting. I'd like to offer the Danville Museum Auditorium as a meeting space to collect public information so that we can do better decision making in the future. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else? Okay, I'm going to close the public hearing. Any questions and comments from commissioners?
Question for Mr. Gilley.
Okay.
Go ahead.
If we say no to this today, a year from now, we're going to be facing the same problem, more likely than not.
Depends on what City Council's action would be.
Right. But this is something, somebody said, we've been here last year, we're here this year. We need to stop this from happening every year. We can't stop that from happening every year. If someone comes to you with a request, you have to bring it to us.
Sure.
That's correct.
I just wanted to make that point.
Oh, yeah, sure. Mr. Wilson?
On the list of proffers related to this, there were things that said not seeking and then ones that were not to left open for use. Is it my understanding that if we were to approve the request seeking a special use permit, that we are also agreeing that that property could be used for drive-in facilities, fast food restaurants, public and private schools and colleges, public utilities, restaurants, places of worship, convenience store without gasoline, public uses, which is seems vague to me, and retail sales that don't include automobiles, boats, recreational facilities, mobile homes, farm equipment, and like. Is that correct? In other words, if we were to say yes to this, we would also be opening up future use for those items without anyone having to come back here?
No, not exactly. But if you'll notice on page 12 of 68, it's seeking a special use permit with following. The uses are still the same as what's under the zoning code. You have certain by right, certain by special use permit. So they would still, under the ones that would be under the NC district by special use, they would still need to come back by special use. They can't, through a proffer and your approval, waive that portion. The uses that would be by right, they could by right, if it's approved, anything that's listed under this list that would require a special use permit in the future would still need to come back for a special use permit.
Okay, so why aren't we just saying specifically for this type of building then?
The applicant generated this list of what they were asking for under the NC district. They removed certain things and kept other things, same as any other proffer. Okay. Now, under that NC district, if it was permitted by special use under NC, this can't exempt them from coming back for a special use. It would have whatever's by right that they're not seeking. If that list, that use was permitted, then they could do it. Any others would still have to come back.
Okay. And I have another question about spot zoning. Illegal spot zoning may occur when this zone rezoning is not consistent with the land use plan for the area and solely benefits the property owner, not the general public. Is there a difference between spot zoning and illegal spot zoning? Yes.
If I can defer to our attorney.
There is a difference between spot zoning and illegal spot zoning. I mean, all illegal spot zoning is spot zoning. So right. Spot zoning at certain times is okay. And the Virginia Supreme Court has created that definition that you just read as the test for whether it's illegal spot zoning or not. And illegal spot zoning is considered to be an arbitrary and capricious decision by the legislative body. But there might be certain circumstances where spot zoning is okay. It does benefit the entire community. And just because a spot zoning situation benefits the landowners, that doesn't mean it doesn't benefit the entire community. So, hopefully.
But what if we determine that that the this did not benefit the whole community, and therefore how would that be seen through the spot zoning?
I mean, if you determine that it was not a benefit to the entire community, then, I mean, you all have to make that decision, and ultimately council makes that decision.
Right.
Then you all would address it in whichever way, whether you vote in favor to recommend or not recommend. I mean, you speak through your recommendation to council, and your recommendation to council wouldn't necessarily say we're denying it because or approving it because. You just speak through either we recommend approval or deny approval.
If I may, just a little further, you'll notice in our staff report, staff says we don't feel this is illegal spot zoning because this is a fairly debatable situation. We have had this case come before us once before. We have it come here now. Staff's not recommending changing the zoning because we don't feel that the transitional office is inappropriate for that site. But if you as Planning Commission do, that's where we feel it is not illegal spot zoning because we have had substantial debate. We've had neighbors. We've had meetings. So in that case, I would, staff's opinion, it is not illegal, you know, but we're not recommending changing it.
So looks, I will say, it looks like the people that would benefit from it don't want to benefit from it. Yeah.
So, go ahead, Mr. Bolton. For clarity then, I think I asked this last time, under the TOC, he can't apply for a special use permit for the convenience market. The zoning has to be changed to, in essence, apply for special use.
Correct. The zoning would have to be changed to ask for a convenience store in a TOC.
Right.
But there are a number of uses that are permitted in the TOC district that staff believes this building could be adapted and reused for. We just haven't had that presented to us.
Right.
So that's why we're not in favor of changing it, because we believe there are other options under the TOC that this building could be used for.
Okay.
I have a question. How long does a building have to, or property have to be vacant before it loses its grandfather status?
It has to be vacant for over 2 years.
And how long has this property been vacant?
Approximately 16 months off the top of my head, and please, I don't have that in front of me. And again, it's designed, arranged, and intended. What this facility was used for, what it's intended. I would have to go back to the state to see when they actually turned in their closure of the gas station, when the business license is closed. I'm going off the top of my head on those figures.
So potentially it could have been 25 months and...
I don't believe so. I don't. We've had various business licenses. We've had some short-term people who've gone in and out. Folks who went in for little bits of time. I'd have to do much more research to make that determination.
So what does the staff foresee as a viable use for this property?
It could be used for a multitude of things under the TOC. It could be converted into a small office, insurance agent, small little a neighborhood hair salon. I mean, there's all kinds of different uses under the TOC. Someone we had mentioned that possibly a small coffee shop, that's a use permitted by special use in the TOC. There are, we feel, other uses for this historic building than a convenience store, and that's why we're not recommending changing the zoning.
If the 2 years runs out when it has not been used, then what? What happens?
They look under the TOC district at these uses that could go in there and apply for something either by right in the TOC or by special use permit under the TOC.
But the TOC would not change after the two-year period?
Correct. The
it
TOC
would not
is
revert
what
back to some other zone?
Correct.
Okay.
It is zoned TOC now. It would stay TOC.
Yeah, everything in the area is TOC.
And I think a lot of the things that one of the speakers mentioned as possibilities probably would fit into that, wouldn't it? I think somebody listed three or four or five things that they would like to see.
There are 17 uses by right and another 23 by special use permit under the TOC district.
So if someone wanted to open a coffee shop, is that by right? They wouldn't have to come before us?
They would have to come through for a special use permit under the TOC.
Under TOC.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Restaurants are permitted under the TOC, item 15 under uses permitted by special use permit. Offices are permitted in the TOC district. Child support facilities, daycares, funeral homes, personal service establishments, pharmacies. There are a number of uses under the TOC that...
All by special use?
No, pharmacies by right, nursing home, doctor's office, offices, general professional, the personal service establishment are permitted by right. If someone wanted to convert it into a beauty salon, a barber shop, something like that, that would be permitted by right. If they wanted to use it for an insurance office, a small doctor's office, dental office, permitted by right.
If they didn't lose their non-conforming use as the gas station, could they continue selling gas and have a coffee shop in the building?
They could continue selling gas, and then they could apply for the special use permit for the coffee shop if they wanted to expand
under
out.
TOC.
Under the TOC. Wouldn't require rezoning.
Okay.
Is there a problem with parking? If it was a convenience store, if it was a coffee shop, how many spots did he have there?
No, we don't feel there's a problem with parking for a couple of reasons. One, there is substantial space in the asphalt outside that they could stripe off and create parking. Also, being in the historic overlay district, the Commission of Architectural Review has the ability to grant a waiver to some of our parking requirements so that, you know, they could adjust the numbers based on the use of the facility. Our opinion, no, that wouldn't be a parking issue.
Okay, any other questions? Okay, then, we need a motion. Yes. Mr. Bolton, go ahead.
I would recommend denial of rezoning application PRZ 2015-0000292 as submitted.
Okay, do we have a second?
Second.
Okay. Call the roll, please.
Mr. Wilson?
Yes.
Mr. Scares?
Yes.
Mr. Garrison?
Yes.
Mr. Jones?
Yes.
Ms. Evans?
Yes.
Mr. Bolton?
Yes.
Mr. Dotson?
Yes.
So we don't need to vote on the that since it doesn't apply.
You still need to on. No, if you voted on the denial, the special use permit would be
right.
Mute.
That's what I was. Right, just move.
Okay. For city council, we would just list it as a non-action because this gets forwarded on. Okay.
Okay. All right. This will go to the next city council meeting, so you have one more opportunity to plead your case and see if they see different than what the commission has come up with based on the
December 15th meeting, not the next.
Okay, December 15th, yeah. Okay, thank you. Okay, the next application is a rezoning application, PLRZ 2015-0000294, filed by Piedmont Place 1 LLC, requested to rezone from OTR, Old Town Residential, to HRC, Highway Retail Commercial, parcel ID 56127. According to the map, the applicant has proposed to rezone to allow consolidation for the adjacent parcel, with the same zoning classification. And along with that is a special use permit application, PLSUP 2015-0000295, filed with Piedmont Place 1 LLC, requesting a special use permit for waiver for increase in building height in accordance with Article 3M, Section C, Item 20 of the Code of the City of Danville, as amended at parcel ID number 56127 and a portion of 57221, as grid 0716, block 012, parcel 000004, and grid 0716, block 02, parcel 000020, respectively, of the City of Danville, Virginia Zoning District map, and the applicant is proposing to construct a 56-foot height, where a 50 is the maximum allowed. If we could have the staff report, please.
The applicant, Piedmont Place 1 LLC, has requested to rezone parcel ID number 56127 from OTR, Old Town Residential, to HRC, Highway Retail Commercial. The request has been submitted to rezone parcel ID number 56172 to allow for consolidation with adjacent parcel ID number 57221, which is zoned HRC, Highway Retail Commercial. Parcels may not be consolidated if they do not possess like zoning classifications. The applicant has also requested a special use permit for parcel IDs number 56127 and number 57221 in accordance with the Article 3M, Section C, Item 20, for a waiver to increase the building height over 50 feet. The applicant has proposed construction of a four-story hotel. At its peak, the hotel will stand 56 feet tall. 31 notices were sent to surrounding property owners within 300 feet of the subject property, and a full report is in front of you. Staff recommends approval of rezoning application PLRZ 2015-0000294 and special use permit application PLSUP 2015-0000295. Approval of the rezoning request will allow consolidation of two undeveloped commercial parcels. Approval of the special use permit will allow construction of the proposed four-story hotel. The additional height is a design feature of the construction. Staff does not believe the additional 6-foot height would be a hindrance or burden to the surrounding commercial or residential development.
Okay, thank you. I'll open the public hearing now. For anyone wishing to speak on this item can come at this time.
All of a sudden, I feel lonely. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I appreciate your time. I'm Mark Johnson, LED Professionals. We're representing Piedmont Place 1 LLC for these requests. I do have a handout I'd like to share with you, if I may.
Okay.
On the rezoning portion of this request has to do with a parcel that was purchased back when the Piedmont Place development was put together and started being developed. It was not zoned properly in order to consolidate into the development, so that's why we're here now to clean up some of those. And that particular property will be consolidated in part of the hotel property that we're looking at for the height request. The hotel, that, if you can, I think there was a handout in your package that kind of shows a lot configuration, which is kind of small and utility laden. There's a lot of utilities through it. That caused us, or the developer, to look at reducing the footprint and raising it a story. That's why we're here. The total height allowed is 50 feet. If you can see on the elevations, I think it's 55.2 inches, and that's to a architectural tower column. The only other thing we could put there would be probably a convenience store. Just kidding.
We might allow it right there.
just kidding. But if there's any other questions, I'd be glad to ask them for you if I can.
Any questions from the commissioners?
Will this be a second Hampton Inn in Danville? Or is there a plan for the other one?
But I understand the existing one would change flags.
Will it face Piedmont Place or
yes.
Piedmont Drive?
It'll face Piedmont Place. No, I'm sorry, Piedmont Drive.
You're okay.
Piedmont. Yeah. The way these hotels are constructed, if you look at all the elevations, all of them look like a front entry almost.
Yeah, right.
Okay. Any other questions? Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Anyone else? I don't see any. Close the public hearing and look for a motion, please.
I have a question. Is that the extra 6 feet, is there anything else in that area that's greater than 50 feet?
No.
The way we define
how tall, how tall is that side at the mall?
35. The way we define height is the vertical distance to the highest point of the roof for flat roofs. Because of the architectural feature, that's where we have to do the height. The actual structure itself is less than, but because of the way our definition is, that's where the couple feet is. The building itself would comply. It's that feature that kind of throws it off. But no, we don't have anything else in that area that is that tall. The Sam's Club is right around 35 or 40. Toyota's well lower than that.
Of course, all of those are on a higher elevation, too.
Yeah.
The new Central Medical Facility that's going in will be right around 45, close to 50, but it's because of the stories and the grade and the slope, it's not really going to be noticeable in our opinion.
Any other questions? No? You can have a motion.
Make a motion.
Yes.
I recommend approval of rezoning application PLRZ 2015-0000294 as submitted.
Okay, Mr. Jones. Mr. Dotson, second. We could have a roll, please.
Mr. Garrison?
Yes.
Mr. Bolton?
Yes.
Mr. Dotson?
Yes.
Mr. Jones?
Yes.
Mr. Wilson?
Yes.
Ms. Evans?
Yes.
Mr. Scares?
Yes. And now we also need one on the special use permit. Yes, sir, Mr. Garrison.
Recommend approval of special use permit application PLSUP 2015-0000295 as submitted.
Okay, we have a second.
Second
by Mr. Jones. And can I have a roll, please?
Mr. Jones?
Yes.
Mr. Wilson?
Yes.
Mr. Garrison?
Yes.
Mr. Scares?
Yes.
Ms. Evans?
Yes.
Mr. Dotson?
Yes.
Mr. Bolton?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. The next item on the agenda is item not for public hearing. Is a request for waiver for paved surfaces at 202 Stinson Drive in accordance with Article 8, Section B, Item 6B of the Code of City of Danville, 1986 as amended. The applicant is proposing to expand the existing gravel access road in place of a paved road. We could have a staff report.
Currently has a gravel access road running in front of its warehouse buildings. JTI Leaf Service is expanding its current warehouse by 106,700 square feet, and the building expansion will cover the existing gravel access road, so they're seeking permission to extend it around the proposed expansion. Gravel access roads are permitted by granting waiver of the City Planning Commission in accordance with Article 8, Section B, Item 6B of the Code of the City of Danville. And staff recommends approval of the waiver at 202 Stinson Drive to allow for the expansion of the existing gravel access road in accordance with Article 8, Section B, Item 6B of the Code of the City of Danville, as amended at 202 Stinson Drive.
Okay. Any questions from staff? Or
this sort of fits into what we talked about in our work session, doesn't it? I mean, gravel?
Sort of. We've done these in the past. Riverside Roof Trust has one. Goodyear, we've done it for them. Industrial operations use it a lot just because it's less wear and tear on the vehicles, the trucks, and others that are going around. Staff's only concern is that the stones don't get actually drug out into the street. They've got sufficient paved area to allow any stones and other things to work out of the tires. we're probably going to have one or two more of these as other industrial operations in the area look at expanding. So,
would the only negative be the perhaps the rocks and all coming onto the
mainland? Yeah, that's the only thing from our perspective is the rocks coming out, and we prefer in that case if they have about 1,000 feet of pavement. In this case, they will have that coming around the facility. Goodyear had, I think, 1,300, roughly a quarter mile of space. Riverside Roof Truss was a little short, but even then, we're not having a problem with rocks getting drug out in the road. So.
We need a recommendation.
Yeah, I'll recommend approval of waiver as submitted.
Okay. Second for Mr. Bolton. And roll call, please.
Ms. Evans?
Yes.
Mr. Dotson?
Yes.
Mr. Bolton?
Yes.
Mr. Jones?
Yes.
Mr. Garrison?
Yes.
Mr. Wilson?
Yes.
Mr. Scares?
Yes. Next item is approval of the minutes from the regular October 12th meeting. Any questions or changes?
I do. On page 3, Mrs. Evans stated, so you don't know what warrants 3 extra bays, not days. Just change the B to the D. Okay. I mean, D to the B.
D to B.
I'm dyslexic.
Okay. That change being made, I have a motion that they be approved.
So moved.
Okay. All in favor? Say
aye.
Any opposed? Okay. And now the approval of the minutes from the October 12 work session, which was a second item. So if I just have a motion that they be approved.
So moved. There is a correction that needs to be made on page 13.
Okay.
Mrs. Whitfield.
What?
I she may have been here, I don't know, but
sorry about that. I didn't even look at that.
Okay. So noted, right?
So moved again.
Okay. And so that was a so moved that we did we get a second?
Second.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? All right. Thank you, Jim and Lynn. Any other business?
Just a few things. One, we do have cases for next month, so December 7th, plan on being here. Council approved the last set of items that you had to go in front of them. Everyone knows the comprehensive plan was adopted at the September meeting, so that is effective. If anyone has, I think everyone has copies of everything. If you need any additional copies or anything, please let me know. I also wanted to introduce our new associate planner, Anna Levi, who comes to us from Greensboro. She's got a master's from UNCG, and she will be attending the meetings. Mrs. Burton will probably not be coming to the meetings just because of a schedule change and some other things. So that's all I've got for you.
All right. Good deal.
Mr. Chairman,
yes.
I want to apologize to you and my other commissioners for last month. I did arrive for the meeting 23 and a half hours late.
Okay. Wrong day.
It came down to that.
I just
why
assumed
you
that the city had that as a holiday.
Okay.
And
All right. Being adjourned.
That was.